difference from bonding orbitals to bonding orbitals to your antibonding orbitals sigma asterisk. So this is a very energy wise, when a high energy involved transition, high energy involved transition, and this is giving very, very high intensity spectra. Your spectra, and another thing, and your district contrast and interpretation also very easy. So this is one. Then another, this is normally in the case of saturated compounds, formation of saturated compound, this type of electronic transition is taking place, such as cycloalkane, another type of pentane, heptane, hexane. This site of electronic transition is taking place. Then another is pi to pi transition. That means this is in the case of that unsaturated compound formation. So from the ground state, pi molecular orbital, that means sp2, then excited pi molecular orbital, sp2. So this case, also this transition is giving a spectra of high intensity, good contrast, good clarity. So this is, so among these four, these are called permitted or allowed transitions. And others are where this another is your non-bonding to that sigma asterisk. Normally, methyl alcohol, methyl chloride, methyl iodide, in this type of compound formation, this sort of electronic transition taking place. And that means saturated compound having your hetero atoms. Your methyl alcohol, oxygen is there, methyl chloride, chlorine is there, methyl iodide, iodine is there. So this sort of, in the transition, this is not giving good contrast, good clarity or intensity. These are called forbidden. Another variety is also your non-bonding to pi asterisk. So that means you normally this sort of your this thing, when an unsaturated compound containing hetero atoms such as carbonyl compounds, nitriles, nitrile cyanide is there, so in, so in this case also this is this sort of your transition is taking place and spectra of low intensity. So this part you have to know, and diagram, if you refer to that any book, spectral spectroscopic book, then you will see that sigma to sigma asterisk, that transition involves more energy. So that means in this transition case, should that lowest level, lower level electron has to absorb more energy to be accommodated in the higher level state. So this is, then next coming, your energy involvement. Next is pi to pi asterisk. This is there, and then coming into sigma asterisk and into pi asterisk. Okay. So now coming to that ultraviolet spectrophotometer or visible spectrophotometer. to what I already discussed yesterday. Anyway, this sort of spectral analysis, that in spectrophotometer should have five important components. One should be the light source from where that light or ray will come, which will strike or hit the substances to excite the electrons. Clear? So depending upon that nature of the absorption or spectra, so your light source should be used. That in the case of UV spectra, so UV light, from where UV light will get, if you are using the deuterium lamp. You know, deuterium lamp, what sort of light it will emit? Those light, that wavelength in the range of ultraviolet spectroscopy, that means 200 to 400 nanometer millimicron. Okay, so in the case of UV spectrophotometer, you use deuterium lamp. Whereas in the case of visible spectrophotometer, you have to use that tungsten lamp, because tungsten lamp also emits such type of light whose wavelength is in the range of visible vision. Clear? So first will be the source of light, but source of ray. Then that light will fall on the monochromator or beam splitter. Monochromator, beam splitter. Where, suppose, if apart from the ultraviolet range, that light wavelength, if other sort of is there beyond that limit, those will be eliminated if it goes through the monochromator or beam splitter optics. So that way it will follow the beam splitter, then it will be splitted into the two parts. So one part of light will go through the sample, that means solvent plus solute, and another will fall in the pure solvent. So after absorption, that two different light after the absorption, because you have made the two parts after this beam splitter, then one part after absorbed by the sample, that means solute plus solvent, it is coming, and another way, your only pure solvent, that way also is coming, and both ray falling on the detector. So detector, what it is doing? It is measuring the difference of the intensity and sending the signal to the recorder. So that way we'll be getting the you'll be getting that ultraviolet spectra or visible spectra. So these are the basic, and some other spectra, some other additional features are there.
Okay,
whenever this sort of short note or other things are coming, so at least these five components you have to write. Then additional, that spectrometer to spectrometer, it varies, so you have to give. So now question is that what is the application, that as per the Macaulay syllabus, main emphasis they are giving everything, what is the application? So if the question coming, what is the application for UV and visible spectra. So then you have to write, first that one is identification of substance. So if it is required that unknown substance to identify, that you can do very well by ultraviolet visible spectra. So you have to send that ultraviolet light through that substance, and what spectra you are getting, that you have to preserve, and that you have to match with the different type of the different UV spectra of different substances. Then you have to match these unknown substances, the name you do not know. So you have
you
to
got
match.
It. When I...
So you have to match with that. So that way, by matching, you can get the name of the unidentified substance. This is the very important application of ultraviolet. Then like that, another is there, your unknown concentration. Unknown concentration. So that also you can do. So you take different wavelength of light, and you take different concentrated solution. Then one particular ray, that light, you pass through the several concentrated then solution and measure the intensity. So then, like that, then when you see that unknown substance intensity is matching near to that concentrated solution, then that way we have to find out that this is the your this thing. What is called? This is the unknown concentration. Then other things also there. Then in biochemical studies, you can measure the enzymatic reaction kinetics. Kinetics, that means rate of the reaction. So rate of the reaction, you can study. So how you can show, you do that, you pass the ray through the solution, and intensity you measure at different time. Suppose reaction started. So then up 0 minute, what is the intensity you are getting? Then after 5 minutes, 10 minutes, like that you are intensity getting. So corresponding to the intensity change with respect to the with the time, you can, if you plot a graph, that is the intensity as well as concentration also. You know the known concentration, how it is changing concentration. You can find out the rate of the reaction. So for the kinetics of the reaction also, this is very much required. And it is widely used in the case of enzymatic reaction, that means biochemical studies. Another also nowadays for environmental studies also, in the environmental studies also, that the substance is having different type of metal ions. So what type of metal ions are there? So that also by absorption spectra, you can measure. So these are the analytical application or uses of UV visible spectroscopy. So this is very important. Now coming to fluorescence and its application in medicine, very important. It is coming. Now, so far we have discussed the absorption spectrum or absorption spectroscopy. So here ultraviolet, visible, and infrared, these are involved. Now we are going to the emission spectroscopy, emission. So emission spectroscopy, now what happens when the electrons in the upper energy level having the higher energy due to certain circumstances. So higher electrons from the higher energy level, it emits the energy and loses the energy content and jumps to the lower energy level. So that way light is formed. So emission, that energy is converted to the light. So this phenomenon is called luminescence. This phenomenon is called luminescence. So what is that luminescence? That when the higher energy electron jumps from the higher to the lower energy level, it emits the energy and that energy is forming a light. So that light is found. So this phenomenon is called luminescence. So this luminescence also, there are two varieties. One is fluorescence, another is phosphorescence. So what is this? The luminescence, what happens? That electron, when it goes to the upper energy level, normally it comes from the layer or energy level, it absorbs the energy going to the higher energy state or level. Actually, due to certain situation, immediately after reaching the higher energy level by absorption of energy, it wants to come back very quickly, instantaneously, within a nanosecond. So nanosecond wants to come back to the ground state level. So that way it releases the energy, and that energy, what sort of light is formed? It is called fluorescence. Fluorescence, you have seen the fluorescence light. So this is called fluorescence. And another also, they are phosphorescence. What it is? If after reaching your higher energy level, it delays. Immediately, it don't release the energy and comes back. Not like fluorescence. So it stays sometime on the excited state, that after sometime more than a nanosecond. In the case of your fluorescence, within a nanosecond, it wants to come back to the again original ground state. But in this case, it is remains there for some time. It got delayed, and then it releases some energy and come back to ground level. So that way, what light is formed by the release of energy, by the image of energy, that light or phenomenon that light produced or phenomenon is called your phosphorescence. Phosphorescence, P-H-O-S-P-H-O-R-E-S-C-E-N-C-E. Clear? So phosphorescence is very important. So it is having so many applications, phosphorescence, in medical, biomedical, as well as analytical application, as well as your nanotechnology. So this sort of several application is there, these fluorescence. So then sometimes then now how the transition taking place, how so that sort of transition was studied by Professor Alexander Jablonski. So he studied on that basis, how this, what is the mechanism of
Sir,
that?
Who?
Professor Alexander Jablonski. Alexander Jablonski spelling is J-A-B-L-O-N-S-K-I. Okay.
Jablonski. Jablonski, sir.
In the your reference book you will be getting.
Jablonski,
He has given the Jablonski diagram by which he explained that what is the basic difference between fluorescence and phosphorescence. So sometimes in question coming that what is the Jablonski diagram and what is the application? So that sort of question. So not much of that diagram is there. To that diagram, you will have to produce. You will say that in the case of this thing, your first fluorescence, your higher state is reaching, and immediately it comes back to the ground state. So that diagram is there. And whereas in the case of phosphorescence, there is some delay in the excited level, and after that it comes back. So that diagram also given phosphorescence, clear. So this is then what are the substances are showing the.
Sir, you will share that diagram in Google Classroom.
That diagram is there. Jablonski diagram, so you can refer that. Then another point, then your example, after MCQ also is coming, that these are the examples of phosphorescence materials. So what is the correct one? So that way, calcium fluoride, yeah, which was the first substance exhibited the fluorescence and which is noticed by the scientists. So calcium fluoride, which mineral name is fluorite. Fluorite, so since it is emitting the fluorescence light, that particular type of light, so on that basis, this name is given your fluorescence light. Fluorescence light, clear. So this is having, these are the, so in this case also if the principles is coming, that we write the principles of fluorescence. So in that case also, you write, this is nothing but the emission spectra, emission spectra when the electron excited and reaching the excited level. And immediately within a nanosecond, it is coming back to the ground level. should be by that process what energy or light is emitting, that is called luminescence. And this phenomenon was studied extensively by the scientist, Professor Alexander Jablonski, and he has given the diagram. We explain the phenomenon as well as to exhibit the difference of that this thing. Okay. So this is the hello students, could you hear? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Sir, mic is not working, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
I am audible. Bolo?
Sir, my mic is not working.
Yes?
Hello? Sir, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, sir, I understand.
Sir, class is about to over. We have to rejoin again, sir.
What happened?
Sir, less than 1 minute is left.
I could not hear. All right.
Sir, we have to rejoin again.
Not.
No.
I am having practical class after that. So not possible. We are also having a lot of load. So okay, next
thank
class.
Thank you, sir.